Hello viewers, welcome to one more edition of MinorCare Positive Life series. With technological advancement in medical science, our life has changed. As an output, we have got various new processes which govern us today. Laparoscopy, minimal invasive surgery, bariatric surgery are such outputs of medical science. Today we have come to Max Healthcare to talk to Dr. Pradeep Chaube. He is the Executive Vice Chairman here, and there are not enough words to describe his credentials. In my words, he is an institution. From him, we are going to learn about laparoscopy and bariatric surgery. Sir, thank you for your time. On behalf of my viewers, I really appreciate that you could find time for us. So I'll directly get into the subject. You have been an institution as far as laparoscopy is concerned. So what is laparoscopy surgery, sir?
Laparoscopy is one modality of operation. So in the conventional surgeries, we were cutting open the abdomen so as to make sure that both our hands or hands of the assistants, they go in. We manipulate the organs, we mend them, we remove them, we connect intestines with other this thing. So all the surgery was done with the two hands going inside the abdomen.
Right.
And we needed a large incision to make the surgery go through. Now, laparoscopy is exactly the different of that. That means that we don't have to make an incision. In place of that, we put a telescope through a very small puncture.
Right.
And that telescope gives us a view of the abdomen inside.
Right.
Now, instead of putting our hands, we put one or two or three more punctures and all our instruments enter inside the abdomen.
Right.
Through that small puncture.
Right.
That means the access or the approach towards the organ is done through the telescope, which has got a camera mounted on top of that, and it gives us an image on our screens.
Right.
So we see everything inside on our screen.
Right.
And with our hands and energy sources, we manipulate the organ and do the, I would say, the same operation done in a different manner.
Right.
If we want to compare it in a general manner, we'll say that you want to go to another destination.
Right.
Now the destination, you can go by aeroplane.
Right.
Or you can go by car or a bus or a train.
Right.
Or by walking. It all depends. The destination remains the same. The aim remains the same.
Right.
So when you put a telescope in the abdomen, it is known as laparoscopy.
Right.
If the same telescope, you put it in the chest.
Right.
It is known as thoracoscopy.
Right.
If you put the same telescope into the joint, it is known as orthoscopy.
Right.
That means that the word scopy means where the scope is going.
Right, right.
And to differentiate various cavities of the body, we change it the name.
Right.
So a sinus endoscopy, a sinuscopy will be through the nose, it will go into the sinuses.
Right, right.
So this way, the trauma of access is reduced, and that is why in technical terms we call it as a minimal access surgery.
So minimal access, minimal invasive sounds very serene for the human body. I mean, that in itself is an advantage. Other than that, would you for our viewers highlight some of the advantages that laparoscopy gives over the conventional methods of surgery?
All right. See, when we started almost 25, more than 25 years back when we started this sort of surgery, we were calling it minimally invasive surgery.
Right.
But over a period of time, we have realized that invasion remains the same. If you are removing an organ, you are removing an organ.
Right.
So then we changed it to access.
Right.
Because what has changed is only the access, how we approach that organ. So now the standard thing is minimal access surgery.
Okay.
And when this surgery was started, there was a very lovely cover page of Time magazine, which I thought explains everything. And the title of that cover page was Kind Cuts of the Surgeon.
Okay.
That speaks volume about, because surgeons have never been kind till that time.
Surgeons have always been kind, but I guess viewers find the pain part going over the kindness.
Yeah, because you have to make a long incision,
right,
to enter the abdomen or a chest or a brain or a joint.
Right.
So I would say that those kind cuts have changed over a period of time. Now, as I said, the aim of the operation does not change. So suppose we are repairing a hernia, we repair hernia through endoscopy, which can be done by open method also.
Right.
And all those organs. So this is one of the advantages,
right,
that the patients can go back, resume their normal activity very soon,
right,
because we don't restrict them for a prolonged rest, and with the restrictions of not lifting weight and not driving car or a scooter or not climbing stairs,
right,
etc.
Right.
So that is just one part of it. Second part, of course, is the cosmetic advantage, because the punctures are 2 millimeter and 5 millimeter and 10 millimeter. The punctures are so small that it's hardly can be seen. So that gives another advantage of cosmesis.
Right.
From surgeon's point of view, I would say, the surgeon's point of view, the biggest advantage which we get during surgery is first a very good illumination. So any organ which we are visualizing, we are putting almost 350 watt of cold light. So it's a great visualization of the organ.
Right.
Second thing is that we are able to differentiate different colors better by the high definition cameras and ultra high definition cameras,
right,
and three dimensional cameras. So that means that we are able to differentiate more than what the eye can differentiate in,
right,
the colors.
Right.
Like in all the cameras you see, there one color, thousand variation of that color you
Absolutely.
See. So that variation helps us. And third, which is the most important, is we get magnification.
Okay.
Because there is a telescope. We were with naked eye, we were not getting any magnification.
Right.
After that, another thing which came was the operating loop.
Right.
So we used to put it on top of that. It was giving us a magnification of 2.5 times to 4 times, depending on the length of the loop.
Right.
But with laparoscopy, we can see magnification up to 20 times,
okay,
very comfortably.
Okay.
So when we are in doubt, we magnify the whole thing, we put the telescope in, focus the telescope, and when you zoom in the telescope,
right,
you see a big magnification.
Right.
That means that if I am stitching something with 20 times magnification, the space between two stitches,
right,
and the accuracy of the stitches,
right,
will be much higher,
absolutely,
than the naked eye, which does not have the magnification.
Sir, it is interesting the way you have highlighted the advantages. Would you please also talk about the complexities, if there are any?
Yeah, the point which we must understand is that when we are doing conventional surgery, we were getting the three-dimensional view. We were getting the depth as well.
Right.
Whereas when we started using a telescope and a camera, we were getting two-dimensional. So depth perception was not as good.
Right.
So we took time to analyze that depth perception.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And now I think all surgeons who are there, they are trained in a two-dimensional surgery rather than a three-dimensional surgery.
Right.
So that is one aspect of it. Second is that as the technology is advancing, previously our eyes were not advancing.
Right.
Whatever nature has created our eyes,
right,
but now because the ball is in the field of the technologist,
right,
every day we get a better camera system, we get a better resolution, we get a better, so that means our diagnostic capabilities are increasing,
right,
our performing capabilities are increasing,
right,
and above all, the advantage is that we don't have to make incisions on top of that organ.
Okay.
So you, like for all abdominal surgeries, most of the cases I would say,
mm-hmm,
we put our telescope around the umbilicus or a navel,
mm-hmm,
and you turn the telescope to your right, left, you operate on the left, you turn the telescope to right, you operate on the right. So you don't have to make an incision. Previously, when we were making conventional surgeries, we were bound by the incision.
Right.
So the organ which you want to operate, you have to put incision on top of that organ.
Right.
But if you have to do anything more than that,
then you have to do an incision
there.
Right.
So now the versatility of laparoscopy has changed. For example, in a person, the gallbladder which is up here, we can remove the gallbladder. And if the lady has got a uterus problem or ovarian problem, we turn the telescope to the pelvis.
Right.
And with the same thing, you handle the pelvis as well. And the person suppose has got an appendix, so you turn on this side, you remove the appendix also.
Right.
So the telescope point remains the same. And you can go all around the abdomen or the chest or the joint with just one puncture. You don't have to make multiple punctures or enlarge the punctures. Previously, many of our operations were where you put incision from here to the bottom. So the whole abdomen is open. So you operate on the left, you operate on the right, you operate on other thing. But in this one puncture itself of a telescope gives you the whole access of the whole cavity. And also in situations like hernia, inguinal hernia, where you have to operate on left hernia and right hernia both, you have three punctures in the midline and you turn the telescope and operate on the left and turn the telescope, operate on the right hernia. So the patient with just added couple of minutes of operation, no extra incision, and it's all done.
Sir, the way you have explained the stuff, I'm grateful, and I'm forced to make a comment here that it looks like science fiction is coming real. And interestingly, just one puncture is giving me access to the whole cavity, and you know, the whole the system can be healed through that process. So is there any restriction in terms of do's and don'ts? Is there a fact that these are the kind of operations which cannot be done? Is there something of that sort?
I think say for example flying, you have to have a very good training. So it's important that the surgeons are trained well. That is one of the vital, because you know, it's not, say for example, not that driving car does not need a training, but I'm just saying that a car, if you are finding it difficult, you can just stop there and be safe.
Right.
Whereas aeroplane, you can't stop.
Right.
You have to land, you have to take off, and there are weather conditions, everything.
The complexity
has to be,
changes.
Complexity changes. As the complexity changes, you have to have a good training background in a good center, that is one.
Right.
And then like aeroplane, you have to have a very good aeroplane, you have to have good avionics which support and help you.
Right.
The same way, a laparoscopic surgeon should have a good equipment, a good camera system with a high resolution, good support systems, because...
And a good team.
Because somebody is showing you a camera, somebody is holding the laser, somebody, so all the instruments of destruction or construction or reconstructions are inside.
Right.
If the cameraman doesn't keep a track of all these pointed instruments, the instruments may be damaging without, because the surgeon will not be able to see which instrument is causing damage where. For that, the cameraman has to keep all the 4, 5, 6 instruments which are in under the control. So
with
you have
great
to have
power comes great responsibility as
absolutely,
well.
Absolutely, absolutely. And if you are trained well, if your equipment is good, if your team is good, then comes the importance of selection of the cases. One should not take the technology too far.
Right.
That means we should stop just before you think you are going to damage the patient.
Right.
And it's always, I call it a strategic retreat of a surgeon.
Right.
You know, one of my famous and very I enjoy talking on those subject is when the surgeon should retreat.
Right.
So it's a strategic retreat,
which
is very important for the team to understand when you should stop laparoscopy and move on to the more reliable way of what we call is a conventional surgery.
Right. Sir, are there any specific diseases or ailments which still is in beyond the ambit of laparoscopy?
Well, of course, the first glaring example is cesarean section. You can't do cesarean section by, as we always say.
Right.
But apart from that, when you have to deliver long, I would say very bulky organs intact, then laparoscopy maybe, you know, it loses its importance.
Right.
But and also, I would say, many years back, the bleeding was also very a matter of concern for us, because in the patients who have got a bleeding disorder, we were not doing laparoscopy because the instruments are so small that you can't stop the bleeding.
Right.
If there is a bleeding, you know, you have to put a pressure, put a good sponge and press it with both hands.
Right.
To stop the bleeding. So, but as I have seen in last 25 years, with we are getting a lot of energy sources and sealants, the blood vessel sealants, bipolar devices,
right,
ultrasonic knives, ultrasonic scissors, which are we getting,
right,
which are working on the ultrasound principle of sealing,
right, right,
the blood vessel. So I think at the moment we hardly find any condition. It just depends on the armamentarium which you have, and it all depends on your experience and experience of the team.
Right, right.
How far they can go with this.
Sir, I mean, I am amazed to know the technology and how it is working on the human body, and how we have moved from elaborate cut to, you know, punctures which are healing us. So at this point, would you be able to highlight, if not in real terms, but maybe a some comparative of how the costs for a patient has changed? I mean, we are talking about technology which is very intensive in nature, so it will have a cost, whereas there is a definitive advantage of using minimal invasion. So from that point of view, is there something you would like to talk on the cost?
So when we talk about the cost, I would always like to put it little on a broader term.
Right.
So that is the economics of an operation.
Right.
Now, economic of the operation not only depends how much you spend on the surgery per se, but also it depends how much man hour you save in terms of your resumption to work.
Right.
Also, we see even for a poor person like say for example a taxi driver,
right,
who has to lift the weight.
Right.
If the guy, if you do a conventional surgery, the guy is not allowed to lift say a suitcase or drive,
right,
maybe for 3 months.
Right.
But whereas in laparoscopy we say you can drive next day,
right,
you can lift weight. So the guy starts,
his earning potential hampered.
Yeah, that is one of the big advantage. So when we look at the economics of the surgery, it's again I would say give an example of the air travel.
Right.
So
right,
you may pay little extra to the air travel, but
the amount convenience,
of time, convenience saved is so much that it compensates for what money extra
so
you have.
So our
paid.
Viewers, I mean, the information from you to our viewers is that you should look at the whole cost economics to evaluate and come at a conclusion.
Correct,
right,
correct.
Right.
And if you do it well, you will find that it is far, far, far more economical than the conventional surgery.
Right.
Because in conventional surgery, the wound complication, like infection of the wound, hernias after the wound,
right, sir,
those things will in a long term may need longer hospitalization,
right,
expensive antibiotics,
right,
repair of hernias on the long term, repair of the complications on the long term. So if you really look in holistically, laparoscopy surgery is economically much better option than the conventional surgery.
The opportunity savings is much more than the opportunity cost.
Absolutely. And also, please do not underestimate the pain factor.
Yes.
The pain is so less that, you know, it gives happiness to the person,
right,
to the relatives, to the family, that the person who has been operated is walking around,
right,
joining them in the family activity,
right,
joining them for holidays, joining. So there's, you know, everything cannot be compared.
So the psychological cost is very low compared to.
Absolutely.
Right, right.
Look at the cosmetics. Every time a person who has a conventional surgery would look at the scar, which is 6 inches or 8 inches long, I'm sure he will not get a good feeling.
Right, right.
He will always say, okay, but it looks bad,
right,
you know,
right,
whether it is exposed or it is not exposed. But having a kind scars,
right,
gives a very satisfactory sort of, you know, feeling of satisfaction.
Right.
And seeing a long scars, nicely healed, everything, but still it has got a psychological disadvantage, that it impacts you somewhere, that I've got a very long bad scar.
Right.
So we have seen that this also, and also in a personal life, the scars are important.
Sir, I was reading it some days back that there are around 65 million obese people in India. And obesity is on the rise because of lifestyle, because of the way we have got into a sedentary mode. In this context, if you can please highlight, what is bariatric surgery?
Okay, now I will say that from 1999, if we look at the Indian data which is available to us, everything till 1999 was absolutely fine as far as the obesity is concerned, because that time we did not have the fast food, we did not have the spare money to spend outside, and mostly we were confined to eating at home. We were we had the transportation, what was not, I'm sure you will recollect that if you make a booking for a scooter, the scooter was delivered 7 years or 8 years
right.
after you have booked it.
Right.
Same thing was true with cars like
right.
that,
right.
Fiat Ambassador, which you have to wait for a long period. But now you think the, so you know, mobility has increased, that means your physical activity is reduced.
Right.
You have got spare money, economics is good.
Right.
You have got ways and means to spend that money outside. And most of the people would like to spend it on eating
right.
outside.
Right.
So you eat some food which is not very healthy, which has got a high caloric value.
Right.
Now the thing was also started with our multi-storied flats, where this with the lifts there. Now please look around all the schools, what they were 20 years back. There was one building and there was used to be one football ground, one hockey ground, one gymnasium and things like that.
And there were no ACs also.
And there were no ACs. And now you see every school, instead of one block, they have got five blocks. And those blocks are made where the playgrounds used to be.
Right.
Instead of the sports period which was there, we have got a computer period.
Right. Right.
So this way we have, on one side we have reduced our caloric burning by sedentary lifestyle.
And we have increased our storage abilities also.
Yeah. And then unfortunately, we in India and Asia have got one gene which is known as a thrifty gene.
Okay.
Now the thrifty gene, what happens is that thrifty gene was evolved over centuries and decades and for the people who are starving. So in a place like India, we were fighting with malnourishment. So that's why over a period of time, thrifty genes came in. That means the thrifty genes conserves the energy. So if you eat a little bit, it just put it across in the terms of fat.
Right.
So that thrifty genes became responsible and came into picture. Previously, during famine and during natural calamities,
right.
we survived because of thrifty genes, because a small amount of food was
right.
enough to keep us going.
Going.
But the same becomes a disadvantage
right.
when you have abundance of food.
Right.
And if you really look at it, all started in 1999.
Right.
And in 2006, when we conducted a study in a public school, we, to our horror and shock, we realized that there are 33% of the children of the class 10th, 11th and 12th are obese. And that is the time when we sort of tossed this idea that every school should have a calculation of body mass index,
mm-hmm.
BMI,
mm-hmm.
which is simple calculation of weight in kilograms divided by height in square meter.
Right.
Can be done at any way. You don't have to go to any laboratory to do it.
Right.
And we sensitized the schools that they should not look at the marks in mathematics or English or other subjects. They should look at the BMI also.
Right.
If the BMI is increasing, they should warn the parents that
right.
the BMI is increasing, this child is going towards obesity.
Yeah.
And any science which deals with that, with obesity, is known as bariatric.
Right.
The word baros and bariatric, those Greek words which indicate the increase in the weight.
Right.
and the related problems. So this, over a period of time, we realized that it is a separate subject.
Right.
And that's how the bariatric science of bariatric came in.
Right.
So anything related with obesity, whether it is medicine, surgery, dietary restrictions, psychological aspects, everything are related to the bariatric.
So, sir, coming back to the surgery part of it, what happens in bariatric surgery? What do we do?
Well, when we talk about obesity, I would say the fundamental thing today may or may not be very accurate is the BMI.
Right.
So, the management of bariatric patients and obese patients starts what is the BMI.
Right.
That is one.
Right.
And what is the comorbid conditions?
Like
high cholesterol levels, diabetes, hypertension, joint pains, etc., etc. So what happens that we start with a lifestyle. No doubt, if you make a pyramid, the base of the pyramid, as in majority of the diseases, you will say, is the lifestyle.
Right.
One has to make changes in the lifestyle.
Right.
We have to add some degree of exercise, walking, swimming, whatever, you know, a nominal. Into add that.
Ideally taking care of the body.
Ideally taking care of the body, not only weight only, but heart, lungs,
right.
Joints, muscles, everything is, including the depression and the psyche is taken care of.
Right.
So we have to look at the caloric value of what we are eating. So we have to reduce that caloric value.
Right.
And the second stage is adding some of the medicines and the drugs,
right.
Which has to be done by the bariatric physicians or metabolic physicians,
right.
And they add certain drugs to help for weight loss.
Okay.
But if it doesn't work, if the BMI is more than 32.5 with diabetes,
right.
And 37.5 without diabetes,
right.
Then the surgery kicks in.
Okay.
That means that it has gone to a stage which has become irreversible.
Okay.
So reversing the obesity and losing the weight and maintaining that lost weight,
right.
Is not possible by even lifestyle changes and by drugs,
right.
Or diets.
Right.
That is a time when we feel that the patient is subjected to surgery,
right.
And that is bariatric surgery. And the bariatric surgery is done as a laparoscopic surgery. So we make multiple punctures in the abdomen, and there are two or three major surgeries which we do. One surgery, of course, is we reduce the volume of the stomach. When I say stomach, it is the pouch,
right.
Where our food goes and stays.
Right. Right.
So you reduce the volume of that stomach by stapling the stomach.
Right.
So when you eat, the smaller amount of food will give you that satiety,
right.
Or a sense of,
right.
Hunger is gone.
Right.
And another is that you add a little bypass. The food does not go into the first part of intestine,
right.
So the fat is not absorbed.
Right. Right.
And this way, generally what we see that in after bariatric surgery, in very indicated patients, they lose weight almost about 6 to 8 kilograms, and this motivates them for a further loss effort.
Sir, what you mentioned about stapling and you know creating a bypass, what are the complexities that we are talking about here?
Well, I would say that the complexities were there maybe 2 decades back. But with the passage of time, what is happening? Because now, as I mentioned, that we have got a very high resolutions cameras, etc.
Right.
And we have evolved on the stapling devices.
Okay.
The stapling devices at the moment are phenomenal. They are absolutely safe, they seal, they cut the stomach. So as these technologies improving, we have realized that the chances of the complications and the leaks and the bleeds have dramatically gone down.
Sir, while interacting with you, I am also realizing that post the surgery, that patient have to take care of himself. I mean, the surgery alone is not the end to it.
Yes, in a common words, I would say this surgery acts like crutches, which allows the person to move from one place to another place like the crutch does.
Right.
So this surgery helps the patients to lose weight with lesser efforts, I would say.
Right.
So instead of doing gym for 2 hours or 3 hours or 4 hours, which right. becomes unpractical,
right.
if you walk for 15-20 minutes, it works well.
Okay.
And the best part of bariatric surgery is the patient feel as hungry as they used to feel before operation. That means the appetite is extremely good,
right?
Which gives a very good feeling.
So the metabolism is not affected by it.
It's not affected. At the same time, when they eat a small amount of food, the satiety is there.
Right.
What satisfies the person that I am full.
And the minimum energy required for the body to function
is already given.
Yes. Yes.
So the body is taking as much calories as is desired,
right.
and the beauty is that the appetite is of a healthy person,
right.
and satiety or fullness is also of a healthy person with a lesser amount of food,
right.
and that is the success story for this. On the other side, the failures of bariatric surgery mostly are related with the patient when they start consuming high calorie liquids. Unfortunately, alcohol is the commonest cause for failure, because alcohol has got empty calories. It has got no value.
No value.
Except the calories it provides.
Right.
And there's no way we can restrict liquids.
And the absorption in the body is also very fast.
Very fast, because it goes straight way to the intestine. But this is the downside of it. But what we have seen, that these patients, majority of these patients, they do very well. And that is the reason we call them frequently,
right.
and the team is important.
Right.
So we have got a team which motivates and continues their motivation in this direction,
right.
so that they maintain the lost weight.
Sir, what is the cost involved in? I can understand that bariatric surgery, I mean, as a surgeon, you will understand the context of that individual and, you know, you will administer a particular process. But what are the average costs related to?
Now, the average cost here, I would say 70% of the cost what a patient spends, the 60 to 70% money goes towards the staplers, because the staplers are expensive. Every fire costs about 10,000-12,000 rupees. So even if there is a 15 fire, you know, you can calculate the money. I would compare it again with a stent in the heart. So putting a stent in the heart does not really cost much. What costs, why it looks bigger or more expensive,
right.
is the cost of the stent.
Right.
The same way, the bariatric surgery, which is on an average, I would say, maybe 2 lakhs, 2.5 lakhs, depends where we are doing it,
right.
and what surgery we are doing and how many staplers are being used.
Right.
If you really look at it, most of it is the stapler, which is
a material cost.
It's a material cost, which has got quite a bit of taxation into this.
Okay.
But as we have been sort of insisting and persisting, and government seems to be taking note of it,
right.
and I'm sure soon the cost of the surgery will go down,
right.
because the structure, the tax, the custom duty and excise duty and all other duties,
right,
which
right.
reduce.
Right.
Once it reduces, we'll see a dramatic reduction in the cost.
Right.
But at the same time, I would say that, again, if we talk about economics, the money which is spent comes back to the patient within 2 years.
Okay.
That means he saves within 2 years.
Right.
What money he has spent on the surgery, he saves that much money, and after 2 years, forever in his life,
right.
in terms of other medications,
right.
like management of diabetes,
right.
management of heart problem, management of kidney problem, dialysis, kidney transplant, liver problems.
It is more an investment than a cost.
Absolutely. And this investment, what you are doing, comes back to you within 2 years. And rest of the life,
right. Right.
you are gaining.
Right.
And gaining financially, gaining psychologically, socially, countrywide, you say,
right.
the economics
right. Right.
of the country, because your productivity increases, the family life becomes better. In the females, the fertility improves after the surgery. In diabetes, disappears in almost 90-92%
right.
patients.
Right.
The hypertension reduces in 70-80% patients.
Right.
the joint problems. And apart from that, I said the inner happiness,
right.
The self-esteem.
Right.
When you look in the mirror, when you dress well in a proper, otherwise, you know, you are always struggling to find the right dress.
Right.
Those small little things. When you go out, somebody scolding you, somebody commenting on you.
The whole aspect of dignity, the whole aspect of how people perceive you,
absolutely.
Goes through an amazing transformation.
Absolutely. And it reflects on your family life and your social life, your evenings, your working space, working place. You have more possibility of getting a better quality of job.
So, you know, summing up on those opportunity costs of all these small things in our daily life, actually converts this 2.5 lakh as a cost as an investment.
Absolutely. And this investment which pays you every year and every day,
yes.
Every hour, every minute, every second.
Right.
And I say that bariatric surgery is the only surgery, if you really analyze it more closely, this is the only surgery which not only affects one organ, it affects the whole body. It affects the liver, it affects the heart, it affects the kidney, every part of joint, muscles.
Right.
And it does not stop there. It goes beyond that it helps in anxiety, depression, fertility. There's no one single operation which has got so widespread advantages.
Right. It is inspiration talking to you. I mean, I on behalf of my viewers would like to thank you for your time and the lucidness with which you explained everything. Sir, a kind word from you as a parting note for our viewers.
Well, I think I always say that viewers that what is most important is not the internet information. It is not the other information, because there are a lot of information which is put on that is not authentic. That is one. Second thing is, when you are looking at any of these informations, please look at the authentic sites and locations where you can find the correct message. Second point is, you must select the good team of doctors and a good institution who specializes into these sort of works, may it be laparoscopy, may it be bariatric surgery, may be surgery for diabetes, as you do it for heart or you do for cancer. So it's very vital. One should not look at the cost, because cost comparison could be sometimes very,
it may be penny wise and pound foolish.
Yeah, absolutely. Because it is not the cost, it is the authenticity and excellence of that team and the institution, which might upfront may look a little more, but in a long term will give you a lot of safety, lot of correct advice which is correct for the person, and help you throughout the life with the support system.
Sir, thank you so much for your time. On behalf of MinorCare and the whole team, I really feel very happy to have had interaction with you, and we look forward to such interactions in the future as well. Sir, thank you so much.
Thank you. It will be always a pleasure and honor.